Foreshadowing in the Bible. The Bible is a massive book full of all types of foreshadowing. When we discussed foreshadowing in the Marvel Cinematic Universe, we saw 7 different types. We'll see many of those types are found in the Bible, no matter what translation or language we read it in. Today, we'll borrow images from the Action Bible, which was illustrated by Sergio Carriello. Our music will be John Debney's soundtrack to The Passion of the Christ, and we'll read from the New American Standard Version of the Bible. Here we go. Let's start with bookend foreshadowing. In Genesis 3, we see it doesn't take long for humans to break their relationship with God. Through self-will, they choose rebellion. Evil is identified, and God promises a hero to crush the enemy. A covering for sin and shame is foreshadowed in the clothing God makes, and the consequence and curse for rebellion gets enforced. Humans are separated from God, and the tree of life is withheld. Turn all the way to the other end of the book, Revelation 20-22, and we find the end of the story. The enemy's influence is for a limited time, and choosing of sides is allowed. The enemy, however, faces certain doom, and all, both those still living and those long dead, are judged by God for their deeds. Those whose names are in the Book of Life are spared from joining the doom of the enemy, and humanity's relationship and nearness to God is restored. There is a new garden, and access to the Tree of Life is granted. One can argue how much of these two bookends of the story are symbolic or literal, but that is a theological conversation, not a study in foreshadowing or storytelling. And although the Bible is inherently a theological book, and we'll find theology embedded throughout the story, especially in foreshadowing, our main focus is to explore how foreshadowing is used in the telling of the story. Right now, we have inverted parallels as bookends. The serpent wins in the beginning, but loses in the end. The tree of life is denied in the beginning, but given for a second time in the end. By looking at bookend foreshadowing, we can see that the beginning and the end share the theme of humanity's choice. The plot is fulfilled. God's promised hero defeats the villain. God's character is intact. He continues to provide a covering for wrongdoing. And that humanity is back in a garden, and the relationship with God has been made new. Essentially, all the problems have been resolved. The struggle has ended. The story comes to a satisfying conclusion because the end matches so well with the beginning. This is the story's natural and expected resolution. Now, how does humanity get from the first garden to the second garden? What does the promised hero do? As best we know, the writing of the story began in 1446 BC and ended in 95 AD, meaning it took 1,541 years, thousands of pages, and multiple generations to tell the Bible story. One of the principal participants was Abram. In Genesis 12, God begins using direct speech with Abram. He promises to bless the world through Abram's descendants. Notice this is a blessing for the world, not a curse. In Genesis 15, God is more specific. God tells Abram his descendants will be slaves, that God himself will rescue them and give them a place to live, namely the land Abram has traveled on. Abram believes God's direct speech, and God declares Abram to be righteous because he believes what God says. So God has directly said through whom the blessing will come. He has identified the coming people group and has claimed control over their future. All this, in essence, also makes the claim that God is the one telling the story. Visual foreshadowing. And then, in Genesis 22, we get some visual foreshadowing in the story of a sacrifice. God has changed Abram's name to Abraham, and the promised son, Isaac, has been born and has begun to grow up. What do we see in this story? 3 times God calls Abraham's son Isaac his only son. There is a donkey. Besides Abraham and Isaac, there are 2 men. There is the mention of the third day. At one point, wood is laid on the son's back and is carried by him. The question is asked, where is the lamb? And the answer is given, God will provide for himself a lamb. The son is laid on the wood. The son is to be the sacrifice. And then a ram, caught in the thicket by its horns, is offered in place of Abraham's son. And then God promises to bless all nations because Abraham obeyed. Because Abraham obeyed, we have this foreshadowing picture. What does this picture foreshadow? The Abraham, Isaac, and Ram story happens here on our timeline. Early enough on that every generation of Abraham's descendants can know the story and tell it to the next generation. It's one of the foundational stories for this people group. Now, according to the Bible, what does it foreshadow? this Jesus story that happens here. John 3:16 says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, so that whoever believes in him will not perish but have everlasting life." Abraham's story has an only son, and Abraham believes God. Mark 1, Matthew 3, and Luke 3 all record a voice from heaven calling Jesus, "My son." When Jesus enters Jerusalem on a donkey, a few days later he is led out of the city with two men. And at one point, Jesus the Son carries the wood. The question, "Where is the Lamb?" and the answer, "God will provide," is echoed in the announcement made by John the Baptist while pointing to Jesus. "Behold, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world." As part of the crucifixion process, Jesus, God's Son, is laid on the wood. Where is the ram caught in the thicket by its horns? Jesus is also the ram. In the prophetic parts of the book of Daniel, written nearly 600 years before Jesus' crucifixion, horns represent kingship. What is the inscription Pilate had nailed on Jesus' cross? "The King of the Jews." What is on Jesus' head? A crown of thorns. A crown represented by branches of a thicket. Jesus is the only son and is also the ram, caught in the thicket by his kingship. The ram in Abraham's story died as a sacrifice. The Bible says Jesus' death was a sacrifice. Jesus says in reference to his crucifixion, "Abraham saw my day and was glad," meaning Abraham understood his moment with Isaac and the ram to foreshadow God's plan. Abraham believed God long before Jesus' day happened, and Abraham was granted righteousness. Romans 3 tells us if we believe, we are granted righteousness. Romans 4 tells us we are actually commanded by God to believe. Hebrews 3 says not believing is disobedience. Direct speech. It sounds like we're getting theological, but whether or not people believe is actually part of the Bible story. God promised Abraham to bless all nations through his seed, so this story is meant for all people. Since God wants people to believe, he includes tons of visual foreshadowing, direct speech, and prophetic dreams and visions throughout the thousands of years leading up to Jesus' arrival. Besides Abraham and Isaac and the ram, the Bible tells the story of Joseph and his jealous brothers, and the story of Moses and the deliverance from Egypt. The Bible lists all God's specific details about sacrifices. The Bible records prophetic songs of David and other psalm writers, the dreams and visions of Isaiah and Jeremiah, along with the lives of Elijah and Elisha. Jesus claims the famous story of Jonah and the whale to be a sign about himself, and Daniel's dreams about the Messiah tell of things fulfilled and yet to be fulfilled. And there are more, lots more of hints and clues. Not all of them are about Jesus' death, but also about the things he would do, his life and his character. We've seen Jesus' death foreshadowed. Let's go back to his birth and ask the question, is Jesus part of God's promise to Abraham regarding his seed? Yes, Matthew 1 records Jesus' genealogy. Abraham was Jesus' ancestor. So was Judah, another prophecy, and so was David, another prophecy. And Joseph and Mary, the mother of Jesus, were descendants of David. Matthew and Luke record the fulfillment of Micah's prophecy. The Messiah, God's eternal living hero, Jesus, would be born in Bethlehem. The year Jesus is born, the Romans take a census, requiring all people to return to their genealogical hometown. Mary and Joseph are required to go to Bethlehem, so Jesus is born in Bethlehem. Psalm 72 prophesied that kings from afar would come bearing gifts. The kings learned from the Jews the prophecy from Micah, so they headed for Bethlehem, and the star agreed with the prophecy. Isaiah prophesied what gifts they would bring. 740 years later, Jesus is born, and the kings arrive with the specified gifts. The Roman ruler Herod didn't like the idea of the Jews having a king, so he tried to kill Jesus by killing all the young boys in Bethlehem. Jeremiah prophesied the lament of these boys' mothers. And Jesus and his family escaped and hid out in Egypt until Herod died. Visual foreshadowing. Herod's mass murder of young boys makes us think back to the birth story of Moses, when the Egyptian pharaoh tried to kill all the Hebrew baby boys, yet the boy that survived became the one to deliver the people from slavery. Like Moses, Jesus survives and delivers people. Moses was used by God to perform many miracles against the gods of Egypt, and Moses led the people to freedom. In Deuteronomy, Moses told the descendants of Abraham, "The Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me from among you." you shall listen to him. In all four Gospels, Jesus performs miracles against demons and leads people to spiritual freedom. When Moses needed to cross a sea, the winds and waves cooperated. When Jesus crosses a sea, the winds and waves obey him. The next time, Jesus walks on water. With Moses, God fed the people miraculously. In all four Gospels, Jesus feeds the people miraculously. Foreshadowing with prophetic speech. Isaiah 35 poetically described the healing miracles the Messiah would perform. Then the eyes of the blind will be opened, and the ears of the deaf will be unstopped. Then the lame will leap like a deer, and the tongue of the mute will shout for joy. 700 years later, Jesus opens the eyes of the blind and causes the lame to walk. Jesus does all the miracles Isaiah prophesied, and many more. Isaiah 53 is an incredible chapter. In just one chapter, Isaiah prophesies that people will not believe the Messiah's message, that he will have a common appearance, that he will be despised and forsaken by his own people, that he will carry away sorrow, sickness, and sin, that he will not try to stop his unjust trial, that he will be declared innocent, yet will offer himself as a guilt offering, that he will intercede for sinners, that he will die with the wicked and yet be buried with the rich, and that he will live again and be appointed by God to justify people. Isaiah 53 says all this 681 years before Jesus comes. Does all this stuff actually happen? Tripwire foreshadowing. Remember the donkey? Zechariah 9 prophesied that the Messianic king would ride into Jerusalem, not on a horse, but on a donkey. Matthew 21 does not say the crowd saw what was happening and pondered it for the next few days, trying to understand. No, they had seen Jesus fulfill enough prophecies. Now they saw Jesus on the donkey and were triggered. They responded by shouting Psalm 118, the prophetic song of the coming of the Son of David. Even as Jesus entered the temple, the children were shouting Psalm 118, Hosanna to the Son of David. The religious leaders saw what was happening, but rather than recognize the prophecy was being fulfilled, they denied it. Challenging expectations. If we go back to Moses in Exodus 2, we see that initially Moses was rejected as a ruler and judge. Who made you a prince or a judge over us? Fast forward to Matthew 21, and sure enough, like Moses was, Jesus is rejected. As a result of this, many of his disciples withdrew and were not walking with him anymore. After these things, the Jews were seeking to kill him. No one of the rulers or Pharisees has believed in him, has he? The Jews in Jesus' time wanted a ruler who would bring about freedom from the oppression of the Roman Empire. They wanted immediate physical freedom, a physical ruler. By not overthrowing Roman rule, Jesus challenged their expectations. God had promised King David an heir to rule as king forever. 2 Samuel 7 recorded that promise. And I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. In Daniel 7, someone with the title Son of Man has a kingdom that is established forever. His dominion is an everlasting dominion, which will not pass away, and his kingdom is one which will not be destroyed. Both these prophecies pointed to Jesus, and although the crowds recognized the fulfillment of the prophecies and rightly called Jesus the Son of David, biologically he was a descendant of David, and prophetically he was meeting the criteria, the title Jesus spoke over himself the most was Son of Man. What's the difference? David was a warrior king, a physical killer of enemies. The scene in Daniel 7 is primarily a spiritual scene. The main participants are spiritual beings. The religious leaders' expectations have been challenged, and they can't handle it. To the religious leaders, Jesus is not a military commander killing off the Romans. He's an annoying prophet who keeps winning spiritual battles over demons, battles the religious leaders can't win themselves, and who keeps denouncing how the religious leaders are teaching the people about relationships with God and each other. Jesus doesn't just challenge their expectations. Jesus challenges their authority. They answer with, the people are drawing the wrong conclusion. Jesus can't be the Messianic King. Foreshadowing with prophecy. But God knew these religious leaders wouldn't believe, so he told the prophets long in advance. Psalm 41 tells that the Messiah would be betrayed. Jesus was betrayed. Where? In a garden. Psalm 41 also says the betrayer would be a friend. Judas was that friend. Matthew 26 reads, Judas went up to Jesus and said, "Greetings, Rabbi," and kissed him. But Jesus said to him, "Friend, do what you have come for." Then they came and laid hands on Jesus and arrested him. To whom did Judas betray Jesus? To the unbelieving religious leaders. The religious leaders dragged in false witnesses to accuse Jesus, which was foretold in Psalm 35. Jesus was silent during his trial, which was foretold in Isaiah 53. Jesus was whipped and pierced, which was foretold in Psalm 22 and Zechariah 12. Psalm 34 foretold that his clothes would be gambled for and that none of his bones would be broken. Psalm 22 foretold the words the religious leaders would taunt the Messiah with while he died. Psalm 53 foretold that he would make intercession for sinners. Jesus says, "Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they do." Isaiah 53 also said he would be killed with the criminals, yet buried with the rich. Matthew 27 tells us that Jesus was buried in the tomb of the rich man, Joseph of Arimathea. Remember the words, third day? On the third day, Abraham's boy lives. Substitution was made way back in Genesis 22. Now on the third day, Jesus lives. Psalm 16 foretold not only of the Messiah's resurrection from the dead, but also of a resurrection for those who believe, as Peter preached, quoting Psalm 16 in Acts 2. Why did all this happen? According to the Bible, John 20, it happened so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing you may have life in his name. John 1 says, "Yet to all who received him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God." But why the substitution? Theologically, if we bring our own views to the table, we may begin to argue that the substitution of the righteous for the guilty isn't fair. We might argue that God wouldn't do that, and our logic for this argument would be based on the idea that we wouldn't do that. But let's look again at the story the Bible tells from the beginning. What is foreshadowed? In Genesis 3, Adam and Eve's shame was covered by God with skins. God could have woven grass skirts, but God chose to cover wrongdoers with animal skins. Something innocent died to cover the guilty. Also, God chose to have the hero be the seed of a woman. No mention of a man, an offspring from a woman, which foreshadowed Mary's virgin pregnancy. And God said that the woman's seed would be bruised while crushing the head of the serpent. John 1:3 tells us that the Son of God appeared for this purpose, to destroy the works of the devil. We might argue, but the Bible tells us Jesus was without fault. Even at his trial, he was proclaimed innocent. Why would God have his righteous, innocent son suffer? Again, the answer has been foreshadowed by the Bible, this time in the life of Job. Job is a righteous man who prays for others, who intercedes for them, and yet suffers incredible loss and tormenting physical pain. His friends make the argument that good things happen to good people and bad things happen to bad people. They conclude that all the bad that is happening to Job is because Job must have sinned. Job says he has not sinned, but is innocent. Eventually, however, Job despairs. After chapters and chapters of these wise men presenting theological debate, God himself shows up and answers Job's three friends with a long rebuke that essentially says, "Who are you to complain or determine God's actions as just or fair? You are merely a created being, not the creator." Then God calls Job righteous and restores him to a place of intercession. And for whom does Job first pray? For his three friends, who didn't understand God's ways. Like Job, Jesus was innocent, yet suffered. And like Job, God established Jesus as an intercessor. For whom does Jesus pray? For us, who don't understand God's ways. In Isaiah 55, God declares mercy and invites sinners to come receive good that they don't deserve. God's logic for doing so is expressed as, quote, "My ways are higher than your ways." God directly says his reason and logic are beyond us. God offers a blessing that undoes the curse. Isaiah 55 is an invitation to accept God's way, the Bible story, and live. But not everyone does this. This story that hinges on people believing God is actually full of people who don't. The religious leaders who were biological descendants of Abraham rejected Jesus and chose to not believe the prophecies were being fulfilled. Many of Jesus' own followers left when his teachings became difficult to understand or when those teachings didn't line up with their own preconceived ideas of God. In all these cases, God was not surprised. he had foretold that some would not believe, and yet some also would. The Jewish people split over how they understood their own ancient texts. The first believers of Jesus, who were first called followers of the way, were also biological descendants of Abraham. They were Israelites, Jews, men, women, children, both uneducated and highly educated, who believed that their scriptures, their early writings about Abraham and the prophets, were fulfilled in Jesus' life, death, and resurrection. And guess what? There were prophecies about how God would interact with these believers that were fulfilled as well. They are part of the story. See Joel and Acts 2. But that's not the end of the story. In fact, Jesus told his disciples they were not to know when the end would come, and that he was returning to heaven for multiple reasons. Shortly after Jesus left, the disciples begin witnessing like Jesus said, and both Jews and non-Jews believe in Jesus. Eventually, the believers are called Christians. And then the Bible tells believers how they should live in expectation of the end of the story. We've seen the promised hero come and do and be all that was foreshadowed about him. And now we're at the end of the story again. With both prophetic foreshadowing and blunt language, the Bible tells the end of the story that is still to come in the book of Daniel and in the final book, the Revelation of Jesus Christ. The Bible states that Jesus is King David's heir, and yet also his root, who has been living forever. Jesus is the one who died, and yet was also resurrected. Jesus' death accomplished God's purposes and restored people to relationship with God. Jesus is the promised ruler from the tribe of Judah. Jesus is the coming conquering king. The serpent, Satan, is the conquered one. And one day, Jesus will return and rule forever. We may have come to the end, but please recognize that this was only a summary of the story. Like all stories, the Bible should be read in its entirety in order to be best experienced. Thanks for joining us for Foreshadowing in the Bible.